Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affair Analysis for 4th January 2020 and these are the articles that we'll be dealing today. The first article for the day is taken from Indian Express and it is titled A Long Fight. This is in the context of India's fight against TB. To start with, the annual India Tuberculosis Report, which is released by the government, says that India is now home to about a quarter of the total global TB patients. So 25% of the world's TB patients are right now in India. So that makes it very significant to contribute towards ending tuberculosis globally as well. So the current government is committed to end TB by 2025. Now in this context, you have to know about Nikshay, which is a computer-based surveillance program for TB patients. It is because of the introduction of this program, the reporting of TB cases has improved significantly in India. So this first step of increasing the notification of TB patients could be very heartening for the government. It is definitely not a good indicator for the public health system. Secondly, when we're talking about hunger, the Global Hunger Index report reminds that a hungry India cannot be free of TB. Dietary deprivation is a direct indicator of inequality and unequal societies cannot be made free of disease and infirmity. In the same context, you have to remember that BMC Pulmonary Medicine Journal from Ethiopia recently showed that the proportion of malnutrition in TB patients was nearly staggering 60%. So, even a very small reason for malnutrition in the community became a very big cause for tuberculosis. The next one is the concern caused by open defecation. It is believed that tuberculosis and sanitation have a direct causal relationship. So there is this integrated disease surveillance program which is run by the National Center for Disease Control. It maintains a web portal that details the outbreak of various epidemics. So, the validity of the claims of the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan through this data showed that there was no statistically significant reduction in the occurrence of vector-borne diseases. Now, you all know that tuberculosis is also a vector-borne disease. So, despite a lot of efforts, even after 2 years of launch of Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, when this data was collated, there was no significant improvement. So, we have to remember that an end to TB is not possible till we end malnutrition, poverty and poor sanitation. In this context, let us have a look at the article written by our Health Minister Harshvardhan. So, what are the government efforts towards reducing the incidence of TB? The first one is increasing awareness. Government has adopted a multi-sectoral and multi-faceted community-led programs in the form of TB Harega Desh Jeetega campaign to create awareness about the problem of tuberculosis and the burden it will cause to the population. Second one is ensuring access. Just after better detection methods used by Nikshay portal and mechanism for better reporting, now government is focused on improving the access to second line of drugs which are able to face multi-drug resistance as well. Thirdly, there are certain schemes like Nikshay Poshan Yojana which tries to address the problem of nutrition for patients undergoing treatment. So, they receive 500 rupees every month for supporting them economically and ensuring nutritious diet is accessed during the treatment phase. Recently, there has been a report called the Global TB Report. So, this report highlighted the need for funding of TB research and development. There is an annual shortfall of about $1.2 billion. There is a World Health Organization's Global TB Strategy in alignment with the Sustainable Development Goal 3.3, which aims to end TB by 2030. Now, we have already spoken that India has preponed this deadline to 2025 and hence our target is considered to be very ambitious. So, in order to achieve this, apart from what the government is already doing, what are the priority areas? The first one is, a new vaccine is to be worked upon and hence we have to pool our resources towards R&D. That is the first requirement. Secondly, there is a need for ensuring diagnostic tests deliver appropriate results at grassroots levels. So currently the problem is we are waiting for a lot of time for logistics and transportation of blood samples from rural areas to suburban and urban centers, and the tests are communicated back after a lot of time, and this will delay our response in dealing with tuberculosis. Thirdly, most of the patients drop out from the treatment course because of the long and lengthy procedure that they have to undergo, which is also considered very problematic for them. So there is a need for shorter drug regimen. All this, when addressed properly, will ensure that India will indeed achieve tuberculosis free India by 2025. That is the gist of this article. Now there is a need for involving private sectors in this entire engagement, because without private partnerships it is not possible for India, because our R&D expenditure is only about 0.63% of our GDP. So that includes R&D in all the sectors, and if you consider health sector, it is even less. Also, our national health profile says that we spend only 1.28% of our GDP on public health. So there is definitely a need for private sector engagement. In this context, try to answer this question. The next article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled Bracing for Global Impact After Soleimani's Assassination. Before getting into the news article, let us understand some background. So, on Friday, Iran's top security and intelligence commander Qasem Soleimani was killed in a US drone attack along with his son-in-law as well as deputy commander of the Iranian-backed militias in Iraq. They are known as Popular Mobilization Forces. So, who is this person, Qasem Soleimani? Yesterday, when we were talking about the tussle between US and Iran, we spoke about IRGC or the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, which the US designated as a foreign terrorist organization in April last year. So, this also happens to be the first military organization of a sovereign body which was declared as a terrorist organization by the US. So it is called the Quds Force. Now this person, Qasem Soleimani, is the head of this Quds Force. So Mr. Soleimani was not only the intelligence leader, but he was also seen as a potential leader for leading in Iran in the future because of his proximity to Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, who is the present supreme leader of Iran. What is the impact of his death? The fact that he is killed is considered a big deal because he has commendable influence in Iran politics. Observers have equated his killing with the killing of a United States vice president. While he commanded respect in Iran, he was by most accounts a very quiet man who did not himself involve in a lot in the public, except in a few occasions. Like last year when President Donald Trump, in his usual style, tweeted threatening the Iranian regime that they should never try to provoke United States again or threaten with any threats or they will face any consequences. So responding to this, Mr. Soleimani has said that they are indeed good at asymmetrical warfare in the region and they are indeed waiting for US to attack. So the strike has left the Middle East on an edge with possible repercussions beyond the region. We heard a statement from President Rouhani of Iran who said that the killing would make Iran more decisive in resisting the US. At the same time, Revolutionary Guards also said that anti-US forces would take revenge across the Muslim world. So this is not a good sign, and Ayatollah Ali Khamenei has issued a statement that he would avenge the death of his military commander. So in this context, what are the repercussions for India? So just like most events that happen in West Asia and Middle East, This incident has an impact on oil prices as well as investor confidence in the markets. So, in this context, crude oil figures have went up in London and New York as they surged by more than 4% to levels not seen before the attacks on Saudi Arabia's oil production facilities in September. So, this is a point of concern because India is right now undergoing an economic slowdown. In this context, the worst thing that can happen for us is increased import bill and current account deficit that will raise the food prices even further and trigger an inflationary trend. The second point of importance for India is the safety of the 8 million expatriates in the Gulf. The next probable impact is that on Afghanistan peace process. So, Iran has a considerable control over the Taliban peace talks process. So, it can affect even that and delay the withdrawal of US troops from Afghanistan. Lastly, one of the most important points for Indian context is the fact that India is home for the second largest Shia population after Iran. So, there is every chance that they might be radicalized in response to this event because even the leader of Iran has promised that he would take revenge for US's actions. So, in this context, we are not only facing external threats in the form of economic crisis but also internal security threats in the form of radicalization. So, this proves the fact that internal politics also affect external politics. And if you compare and contrast with the situation in India, this is not the best of times to portray India as an anti-Islamic country. So, in this context, we have to address our internal concerns first and then take care about diplomatic issues. So, in this context, you have to understand that Iran is not just important for economic purposes in the form of oil, but also they are important for geostrategic concerns as well as we hold certain civilizational ties with Iran. Keeping this information in view, answer this question. The next article for the day is titled Horror in Kota. This news article is broadly regarding the unfortunate number of deaths across various state hospitals and the state of poor infrastructure that mars the delivery of public health, as well as the lack of any emphasis on ensuring quality healthcare to its citizens. So, there is a need for accountability in public health delivery, which is the biggest concern right now. Now, what happened in Kota? In Kota, there is only one hospital which is dealing with pediatrics in that region. So, it is the only referral hospital. What do you understand by referral hospital? So, any case that comes from primary healthcare center or community healthcare center will be referred to a district level hospital which will deal with specialized cases. So, in this area, in Kota, Rajasthan, this is the only hospital that deals with specialized cases for children. So, there should be enough infrastructure and manpower to handle such cases. But both these are lacking and the result is 100 kids have passed away in last December. The usual response has been to blame the previous government and a request not to politicize this. But the fact is, health should become a top priority in politics and it should indeed be politicized and it should become a matter of public policy. It should become a point for electoral politics. It should become a top priority. Now, if you look at the reasons, what are the reasons? Broadly, across all the public hospitals in the country, the common underlying theme is lack of capacity for carrying out the functions and lack of funds. Because, like I've already told you, National Health Profile already quoted that we spend only around 1.28% of our GDP on public healthcare, which is grossly insufficient. Our out-of-pocket expenditure is as high as 70% of the medical care expenses. So, this is unacceptable. There is a severe shortage of equipment for maintenance, and also the present case showcases that there is a 30% deficit in nursing staff to attend to the needs of the patients. Instead of blaming different governments in different states and making them issues for gaining electoral sympathy, we should look towards certain conclusive solutions to solve this problem. Whether it is the Gorakhpur incident or the present case of Kota, the fact is every death in a hospital is seen as a failure that should be addressed immediately. Governments must make public health a priority. We cannot take it for granted. For this to happen, we need regulators and oversighting mechanisms to fix accountability and put everyone in their place. Strict measures should be taken for non-compliance and apathy. So the prerequisite for public health is accountability. That is the harbinger for change in the public health delivery system in our country. In this context, try to answer this question. The last article for the day is taken from Indian Express and it is titled Maharashtra's second farm loan waiver in 2.5 years. What is the difference between this? So, not just Maharashtra, we have had various state governments who announced farm loan waivers worth 850 million rupees in the last few years. So, what will be the impact? So, this decision to go for farm loan waivers will negatively impact banks' credit offtake or the ability to give commercial loans and cause further stress and amount to another agrarian crisis. So, this is a vicious cycle. So, let us try to understand exactly the meaning of the word farm loan waiver. Farm loans are either crop loans or investment loans taken from banks to buy inputs or agricultural equipment. So, we all know this. So, when there is a poor monsoon or a natural calamity, farmers would therefore not be able to repay their loans. In this context, the center or the state governments will take over the liability of the farmers and repay the banks. Now, what is the issue? If the government is repaying the banks, why should there be a concern? Waivers are mostly selective, that is, only particular loan types and particular categories of farmers or loan sources may qualify. So, if you want to take the example from almost a decade ago in 2008 when the global financial crisis has hit India as well, crop and investment loans were completely waived for marginal and small farmers, that is for those with less than 2 hectares of land ownership, and other farmers were only given a 25% reduction. So, is it right to say that farm loan waivers are good or bad? Let us have a look at the arguments in favor of farm loan waivers. Agriculture in India has been facing several issues. The most important one among them is the fragmented nature of our land holding and the depleting water table, which further deteriorates soil quality, increases input costs and low productivity. So, there are a lot of issues which cause farmer distress, and fragmented land is the main reason for that. Secondly, output prices for farmers are not remunerative because farmers are forced to borrow to manage their expenses. This indebtedness has triggered a lot of farmer suicides in India, and thus farm loan waivers will definitely give some relief to farmers in such situations. So, what are the arguments against farm loan waivers? Farm loan waivers are considered to be just a temporary solution which might help the government buy some peace with farmers in the short run. But the fact is, it is unlikely to change much on the ground, and the reality is, it is just a relief for one season with the farmers going back to distress in the next season. So, you don't want such kind of solutions. Now, there are various studies which tried to study the outcome of loan waivers, and it was proved beyond conclusion that they do not lead to high investment or better labor market outcomes. So, why go for them? The third problem is the loan waivers can negatively impact the credit flow because it creates some sort of distortion in the credit market, and it will also increase the non-performing assets of the bank. Also, no improvement in farm productivity for households qualifying for Loan waivers reveals the failure of the program to achieve its desired goals. The next problem is increase in the fiscal deficit of the government without anything in return, except for maybe vote bank. It is also proved that farmers, upon the hope of getting farm loan waivers, will increase their expenditure and reduce investments. So, this will negatively impact the productivity in agriculture. It is because of government's policy to go for farm loan waivers, we see a crowding out effect where credit is not available for business activities. And lastly, this will lead to ugly vote bank politics without taking into considerations the real issues on which the government should deliver. Now, this has happened again in Maharashtra, and this is different from what happened the last time. The difference from this scheme to what the BJP government gave the last time is that, unlike the previous loan waiver, this latest scheme will see outstanding crop loan up to 2 lakh rupees. The previous government, irrespective of the size of land holding, waived off loans up to rupees 1.5 lakh per family. There was also this provision where farmers who made regular repayments got rupees 25,000 for their good credit behavior. Now, in the new scheme, the issue is that every farmer, irrespective of the fact that whether he exhibited good behavior or not, there is a complete farm loan waiver. And secondly, unlike previous attempt where only one account from a family was eligible for farm loan waiver, in this case, every account holder, whether he is from the same family or not, is eligible for waiver. So, take this case where there are four people in a family and four of them took farm loans, and all the four loans will be waived off. That will be, for example, if each one of them took two loans, 8 lakhs will be waived off. So, this is considered to be a very problematic issue because as much as 26,000 crores of outstanding loans are promised to be waived off. We have just seen why farm loan waiver is not just a moral hazard but also bad economics. So, in this context, please try to answer this question. That's it for the day. Thank you.